Our scripture this morning comes from John 20, 1 through 18, and Luke 24, 1 through 12. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight to the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciple went back to where they were staying. Jesus appears to Mary Magdalene. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb, Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, New Millennium Church. My name is Reverend Curtis Davis, and I come to you this Easter Sunday morning from San Diego, California, better still, from Spring Valley, California, just east of San Diego. What a beautiful day outside. It's sunny here at the time I record this message. And I thank Reverend Griffin for sharing his pulpit with me this morning, and it is my honor to bring this message to you, this title, again, Easter Triumphs Over Good Friday, again. And it's from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. Let us pray. Lord God, we're so grateful and thankful that you are our God. Lord, you who sets high and look low, in your love, mercy, and grace for us, Lord, you continually invite us, Lord, to come to your divine table and to sup with you of your, Lord, of your word. And so, Lord, I, your servant, who you have tasked with that this morning, of the setting of your table, Lord, ask that you would reduce me and increase yourself. Reduce me and increase yourself, Lord. Reduce me and increase yourself, Lord, that I, in humble obedience, Lord, would only set that which you have ordered up. Adding nothing and subtracting nothing, Lord, from your divine meal this morning. Lord, that both speaker and hearer, Lord, will receive the full intent of this your divine meal. Lord, that we may be built up, reduced, corrected, and directed, Lord, as you have so ordained through the consumption of this meal this morning. And Lord, that you alone might be edified and glorified by our fellowship this morning. We give you eternal praise for this opportunity in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And all of God's people said, Amen. Amen. Reading from Luke's Gospel, the 24th chapter, verses 1 through 12. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in the clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered up over the hands of the sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed like nonsense to them. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen land by themselves, and he went away wondering to himself what had happened. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You know, the longer I preach, the more difficult I find the special days like Easter and Christmas to preach. On one hand, the messages are already written for us in both the Old and New Testaments, especially in the Gospels. But the struggle is how to make it fresh, how to make it new, while staying true to the topic and the subject at hand. And I'm so thankful for God's Holy Spirit. And I'm thankful for the spiritual mentors that God has placed in my life down through the years, all to guide me through this maze of Easter and Christmas. Now, having said that, let's see where we go this morning. As we open this message this morning with the words from the gospel hymn, No Greater Love, by the Gospel Music Workshop of America's choir. For there we find verse 2, referring to the events of Good Friday. as they sing, they hung him high, they stretched him wide, he hung his head, and then he died. That's love, that's love. And with verse 3, Easter Sunday dawns, and it begins with, that's not how the story ends. The lectionary for Easter 2021 gives a choice of John's Gospel, chapter 20, verses 1-18, the baptizer's narrative of the the empty tomb, Jesus' first appearances, and Luke chapter 24, verses 1-12, the doctor's narrative of the risen Christ. I was reading both texts in preparations for this morning's message, seeking guidance as to which one to use, and I found that I could not get beyond both. The word again kept jumping to the front of my mind, again. I flashed to my children, my granddaughter saying, again, again, granddad, again, again, dad. You know, they would say this when they wanted to repeat something they were really enjoying. You know, a story or a game or any activity that was bringing them joy. And as I read both texts, I kept finding myself saying, again, again, tell me the story of the empty tomb. Again, again, tell me the story of Jesus' first post-crucifixion appearances. Again, again, Lord, tell me the story of the risen Christ. So this morning, we the redeemed rise up together to say, again, again, tell us the story of Easter's triumph over Good Friday. You see, because saints, this is a celebration that brings you and me here this morning. This is the truth we say, tell us again and again. As hard as it was for me to choose between the two texts this morning, I finally chose to focus on Luke 24, 1 and 2, while combining some elements from John's Gospel, chapter 20, 1-18. Around the time of Easter, we find the newspaper comics. We find that we can expect them to touch on the themes of Holy Week and Easter. And down through the years, I've clipped some of those out when I can use them in my sermon text. And I have a favorite one that I like to go to. It's from The Wizard of Id. And that strip has hit me hard down through the years. And so I say again and again, tell me Easter's triumph over Good Friday. In that installment of the strip, Id's king comes upon a church with a sign out front proclaiming Good Friday. And the king says to the pastor who's standing out front, Pastor, let me get this straight. God comes to earth and is one of us, and we kill him, right? God says, yes, that's right, king. And to which the king says, your Lord is dead. There's a big earthquake, and the curtain in the temple is torn from top to bottom. Right again, says the pastor. To which the king replies in astonishment, what's so good about that? To which the pastor looks at him, clasps his hands in front of him, big smile on his face. What's so good about that, king? His curtain call. If Luke's and John's text for today's message were not true, if the events of Easter's morning didn't happen, the king would be correct in his thinking. If there's no curtain call, it all ended with Jesus' death. What's so good about Good Friday? Again, we say Easter's triumph over Good Friday. You see, it's this curtain call that you and I celebrate this morning. Think about all the Christian-themed movies and plays over the past several weeks, especially last week. This past week alone, a number of them aired on TV. Even a couple of them debuted in the theaters in this pandemic. Charlton Heston's old movie, The Parting of the Red Sea, again this past week, leading the people of Israel out of Egypt. Many films were shown this week depicting Jesus' short ministry, his passion, walking us through the drama of his last week on earth, the week we call Holy Week, from Palm Sunday's entry into Jerusalem until his body is laid in the tomb. That is the drama, the main body of the play. The curtain call of his resurrection from the dead is so much more, though. But we need to be reminded that the New Testament offers no account of the resurrection of Jesus. We have instead reports only of the empty tomb. And in the weeks to come, the weeks of Easter season, we hear stories of the encounter of the risen Savior. But we have no stories, saints. No stories, no account, no evidence, if you will, of the actual resurrection event. All we have is the empty tomb of John and Luke's narratives. Joseph of Arimathea claimed Jesus' lifeless body and laid it in his own tomb, the one he reserved for himself. The women saw this done, and then, in keeping with Jewish law, left for the duration of the Sabbath, for the law prohibited any work done on Sabbath day. And this is where today's story begins, because that's not how the story ends. The Sabbath had ended, and it's the first day of the week, very early in the morning, our text says. The women come to the tomb with the spices they have prepared for the body. They find the stone that had covered the mouth of the tomb had been rolled away. And that's a tough thing to do, because that stone is picked for a purpose and is fitted, is chiseled to fit over that tomb and seal it. And when they roll it in the face of the tomb, it drops down into a notch in the ground. And it locks and it seals in place, as if it had a lock and a key on it, never to be opened again. So it takes a miracle to open that. And so when they get there, they find it rolled away. And when they enter the tomb, the women find that the body is not there. And while they're wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleam like lightning, heavenly messengers, if you will, ask, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here. He is risen." The scripture tells that the women ran to tell Jesus' disciples and all the other. And that's where today's gospel story would end. But it's not the end of the story, and not even the end of this part of the story, because it says that when the women get there to tell them the news of what they've seen and what they'd learned inside that tomb, that the tomb was empty, the men don't believe them. In fact, they say it seemed like nonsense, Luke says. But another version said it seemed like an idle tale. You see, saints, there is a difference between standing in the tomb as the women had done and standing outside. The view is different. The perspective is different. One sees things different. One sees things differently. The women, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, are named as men among the company that early morning. They had followed Jesus from his trial before Pilate to his crucifixion on Calvary. They had stayed with him at the cross. They were the first to witness the resurrection. Jesus had said to his followers that they must pick up his cross, you and I even today, to follow him. And certainly these women had endured the cross while the men ran away. And we know that Peter even denied even knowing the Savior. These women, though, stayed at the cross and later entered the tomb to follow him. And so their view, their perspective, was an Easter faith. They had walked the path to Calvary. And so they had eyes to see the heavenly messengers where they expected to see their Lord. And they had ears to hear them ask, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here. He is risen." Which gave them another thing, another perspective. A perspective of belief. For they believed. They believed enough that they were able to go back and share. The men, on the other hand, the men were frightened. They ran away from the cross. Peter even denied knowing Jesus. And so when the women came to tell them the news that Jesus had risen from the dead, the men didn't believe him. And when Peter, ever impulsive Peter, got up and ran to the tomb to see for himself, did he go inside? There's controversy on this issue. John's record says yes, while Luke's offers no conclusion. And much fun has been made over this issue with gender differences in this story down through the years, and how later faith traditions developed understanding along gender lines, and so belittled the first to believe and exalted the authority of those who did not believe. And saints, this is a field that's ripe for exploration. And while there may be a point the gospel writers wish to make about such matters, that's not the point of my message this morning. No, saints, that's for another day. You see, the point this morning is this. There's a big difference between standing inside the tomb in place of the resurrected Lord and standing outside the tomb, stooping to look in. You see, one is a place of an Easter faith, a conviction of things known, though not seen. The other place is stuck in the events of Good Friday and can believe the horror, the death, and the fear, and hasn't quite made it to those things even more difficult to believe. Things like the loving goodness of God, generosity of his kindness, his forgiveness, and the hope offered on Easter morning. You see, the difference between standing inside the tomb and standing outside looking in is the difference not of men and women, but of Easter resurrection triumph over Good Friday death. It's a triumph of courage to believe over a skepticism that isn't quite sure. It is a triumph of celebration and wondrous news over disappointment and despair of Good Friday. It is a faith of Easter which knows the agony of Good Friday and knows that it's not the end of the drama. No, saints. It's a faith of Easter which knows there was and is a curtain call. You see, saints, when we stand in the place where John stood, stooping low to look into the tomb with our own doubt and our own disbelief intact, what will we see? We'll see only a dark cavern, shadows, dust, and death. In fact, John records this for us in his own words in chapter 20, verse 9. He says, "Finally, the other disciple, I, who had reached the tomb first, when I finally went inside, I saw and believed." You see, saints, when we seek our Lord in the tomb and we stand with him in the darkness, we see and believe. But what then will we see? Will it be those same heavenly messengers in clothes of lightning? Probably not. But we will see the emptiness, and we will know the reason for that emptiness. It is an emptiness not of doubt, despair, and disbelief, but an emptiness that signals something new. An emptiness that signals something renewed. An emptiness that signals a triumph over the impossible, a hope, and a promise greater than our imagining. And when you and I inside that tomb look past the darkness of that tomb, back toward the opening to the world outside, we will see light, a dazzling light, blinding light, a shimmering curtain of light, the curtain call of Easter, the light of Christ. And we will know for certain he is risen. He is risen, saint. And we can say, hallelujah, 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 he is risen indeed. And we say again, 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 Easter has triumphed over Good Friday. Again, again, Christ is risen, and Easter has triumphed over Good Friday. Let us pray. God of creation, creator of all things new, the silence is broken, the silence is broken, and again, Easter triumphs over Good Friday. With the women in the garden, we catch our breath, we catch our breath. And we wipe our tears, for joy has come in the morning. And we try to articulate our experience with you, Lord. Oh, how difficult it can be. Because what words can describe shadows fleeing from the tomb? Oh, Lord, in the brilliance of the messengers, how can we tell of the morning the world turned upside down? Jesus has risen. Death has been defeated. No mortal words will do, Lord. No mortal words, only divine words. Still, we must spread the news, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Christ has risen. Again and again, Easter has triumphed over Good Friday. Our knees are weak from running. Our voices tremble on the edge of fearful joy. Again and again, Easter has triumphed over Good Friday. Our eyes have seen the glory of the Lord loosen upon the world. May every breath we take, every word we utter, everything we do, witness to the truth of Christ's resurrection. Again and again, Easter has triumphed over Good Friday. And so, Lord, this we pray in the holy and precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Again and again, Easter has triumphed over Good Friday. In Jesus' name, and God's people said, amen.